What's up, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of the Dangerous When Focused podcast with myself, Sean Bryan. This week, we're joined by Mr. Ryan Kelly, aka the Pirate Tattoo. Ryan, welcome. Thank you for giving us your time. It's an absolute pleasure to actually have you in the shop and so I can pick your brains and maybe talk tattoos for the next hour. How are you doing?
I'm great. Thank you for having me. It's my pleasure.
So we'll go straight into it. I kind of want to get to have a chat with you. I love your brand, Heartbreak Social. The whole idea of this podcast is to get to know not just Dublin people, but people that have businesses in Dublin that have set up their own brand, that are go-getters, that are dangerous when focused, but people that I think add value to the city. And I'm just real passionate about supporting local. It's written above here. We usually have it in most of the shops. I like trying to keep Ireland, you know, the roots and culture of Irish legends and craftspeople enriching our city and telling us our story. And I love what you've done with pretty much your brand, but I want to kind of get to know you because I see a lot of your work online, but I don't see too much of you, which is nice because I feel like everyone's TikToking and taking selfies. Can you take us back to, I know where you're from, Ballinteer. I want to get straight in. When did you first get into tattooing, or can you tell us how you finished up in school, or did you finish school and do a leaving cert, and what was your first job even?
Yeah, I finished school. I was young, 16 in sixth year, so I was a little bit unsure what I was going to do. Yeah. I always kind of had this inkling that I wanted to go to the army. School wasn't going too great, and I was like, I'll try get a cadetship, you know, so give me a bit of a target in the Irish Army. Yeah. And into sixth year then, I was like, right, I'm not going to get them grades. So I was signed up for general service and I was like, I don't even need my leaving cert now, sort of thing. So kind of checked out. When I left school then, I was going to the army. The year I was going was 2009, so it was recession. And when I was meant to be going in, there was like a hold. So I then kind of had a bit of space to wait around for the army, essentially.
Okay.
So when that happened, I ended up getting a tattoo, kind of fell in love with it. Got an apprenticeship, and then the army came back around. I just stayed. I didn't go. So it was a blessing in disguise, I think.
So that's mad. So I remember that time well. I'm 37 years of age. You are 31.
31, yeah.
Just so people know, kind of around that time, my dad is in the army. He just retired. Right. He was in cattle brewing for, I think you could do 27 years, which is the max.
Yeah.
And he's obviously 60 odd now, but he did it and loved it. And it's not as easy. Years ago, it was a great, he wouldn't mind me saying this. He wasn't great at school, left early. But when he got into the army, he was into fitness. He liked regime. Is that it? What's the word? Mm-hmm. Routine.
Routine, yeah.
And he loves working like that. He then came on to become a chef, an award-winning chef within the army. All the rest, my uncle served in the army and they loved it. And I remember thinking, oh, do I want to do the army? Mm-hmm. I wanted to be a fireman, I think. You know, when you're a kid, you think action man.
Looks cool, yeah.
Looks cool. Footballer, the very stereotypical things. But I remember that time, I finished school at 16 and it wasn't for me. And I was like, can I join the army? I was like, no, what can I do? You finished school, you did your leaving cert. Very young though, right?
Yeah. So I was 17, so just probably getting my results then.
And did you ever do part-time work, like, you know, up like lounge boy or working in Super Value or Dunn's?
Nothing at that stage, no.
You were focused on studies or not really?
I was, like I was saying to you earlier, I'd got my Rob Lipsit program. I was mad into the gym. I didn't drink till I was, I think, 20. I was very, you know, clean. And that's what the army kind of was like.
Okay.
At the time, it was lining up where I was like, I want to be fit. I want to be, you know, super soldier. And
I was actually messing. I was drinking cans and trying to be play to be a snooker player, and then I wanted to become a footballer. They didn't work out, and then I think I actually was drinking at 16 and going weekends and sneaking into nightclubs in town with fake ideas,
which is the norm.
Which really is the norm.
Yeah, like I have all my mates that none of the others weren't drinking. I just didn't. Yeah. You know what I mean?
I didn't take drugs. I remember all the lads were kind of. I probably definitely tried them. Mm-hmm. I remember everyone kind of heavily took drugs around the time, and then I got into cutting hair about 21. What? Oh yeah. What? Sorry. What was your first tattoo you said there? Did you say you got your first tattoo at like around what age? 16?
16 probably, yeah.
What was it?
I'd always wanted tattoos. I always loved them. I never thought of it as a career. And so if I got one at that age, like my mom would have been like, you're out of the house, like there's no tattoos, you know? So my granddad passed away and I was like, this is the perfect fucking one to get.
Yes.
So I was like, I'm going to go home. I'm going to be like, it's for granddad, you know?
Yeah.
So I got a tattoo for him, came home. And so that kind of, she was like, no more, but half an excuse to get one. I did like him, you know, but I was like, I can also get one for him and not get in too much trouble. So that was the first one. I wasn't that too crazy, you know?
Yeah, I always remember your first tattoo. Yeah. So, yo, can I ask what it is? Is it like your granddad's
name? It was just
name?
Like Roman numerals in here. Yeah. Of like the day he passed, whatever.
That's nice.
So it was straightforward. Like, yeah. It was like, she was like, it's hidden, it's grand. But I remember getting that done and I was like, this is it. Like, I have to do this.
You know? Was it sore? Like, I don't know if you can remember like 15 years ago.
No, it was okay. I remember thinking it was okay. But like when I was that age, I used to like, I could get tattooed all day long. And like now I can't think of anything worse. The second I start, I'm just, you know, I don't know what it is, but the pain threshold is long gone for me.
This is why I'm dying to chat to you, right? I got my first tattoo, which I've just shown everyone. I'm not showing anybody on camera, and you can guess in the comments below what it is. Keep them clean. Well, you know what it is, but it was terrible. But I'll tell you what I actually went in to get. I went in, and I was an Eminem fan, and I wanted Eminem either written on the top of my back, like a football jersey, or on the bottom of my back. Eminem. The Eminem show was out, and I went into the place in Stevens Green, and they were like, no, if you had the other options, and I was going out with a girl at the time, and I won't say her name, but I wanted her name. It's a big, long name. And I said, can I get her name there in old, bold English? And they were like, no. Fair play to them. Yeah. I'd love to know who them guys are or were or whatever the name it is. So you got your first tattoo. On the podcast, we try and talk because it's very important that not everyone's a business owner that we get on, or maybe they are, or they have a brand. What did you do then kind of to make money after that? Hopefully it was legal, as I'm sure it was.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
You know, like, I it's really interesting to hear people's stories. We're like, you know what? I was in a bar and then I ended up having a conversation with somebody and they said, you have a good personality and this is your interest. So what did you do until you set up your own brand, or, you know, what was your way of making or surviving when you're a young man?
Like before I started tattooing, when I had started my apprenticeship, obviously it's unpaid. So, like as an apprentice for 2 years, you don't get paid. Initially, I was doing personal training. That's what I was doing.
You really work on down the fitness?
Yeah, that was realm, like, it was kind of a 50-50 at that stage what I do. And then I got a job in a gym called Total Fitness. And the week I joined, it went into liquidation. And I remember just thinking,
is Total Fitness still around?
No, it's getting
snapped. I think they're all gone. The one that I was at up my way was like, I think the first one that went. And then the other was like Blanche has one, I think.
Yeah. Wow.
But when that then went down, I was kind of, you know, it was like a big moment. I was like, I'm going to work here as a personal trainer.
Yes.
I'd done like a 6-month course, all that stuff. And
you're in
like,
pretty good shape.
I was in great shape, believe it or not now.
No, I do. You look good.
Yeah. And then when that fell apart, then I was just like, right, I'll really go for the tattoo and
did
do
you,
that.
Just so it was very relevant. Did you get any more tattoos like when you were away? I don't know if you went away with the lads to like Greece or Spain.
No, nothing mad. Like by the time I started had started the apprenticeship, I was just turning 18 maybe, and like had maybe got one or two other little bits from the same guy, nothing crazy, you know. It was tame, you know. So yeah, when I was going into the tattoo shop, did my apprenticeship in Dublin Inc, which is just on Cows Lane. So
where is Cows?
It's right here, just one facing.
Oh, sorry, I'm getting mixed up. Yeah, I'm thinking of.
So, and that was back, obviously, it's different owners and all now. It's long gone, the people that were there.
Yeah, yeah. But, that's just, you know what's funny? That's literally from even the whatever the last owners, but it's now like a nail or brow.
Yeah,
salon.
I only walked by
6 weeks.
Yeah.
Beautiful space.
Yeah, I haven't been there, like walked down that street in, like, say, 6-7 years. So
it's
when I was coming here, I purposely walked down it and I was like, was mad. Like, I remember the
were
first
they open
day
when you walk by, you know, you still see into
you can still see in and see, yeah, it looks the same, you know, but
it's a nice space.
It is a cool space. So yeah, it was like nostalgic to see it. That's where I went to get the first tattoo, went with my brother, and it was like to walk back up. It's just weird, you know, when things are gone, then it's even more nostalgic. It's just, it's, you know, when you say they're not around anymore, it's kind of an odd feeling. There's a new story in there, you know.
It's funny, right, because I think it's very important that people, how we view the streets of Dublin. I love romanticising Dublin. Mm-hmm. I love that when I walked up Capel Street, I used to live on Capel Street, and I would have seen your first business?
That's the first one.
So I remember seeing this place. And I was like, I was nervous. It was a barbershop. I was like, fuck, man, this is looking slick. I seen the pink neon. I was like, bollocks. I've never really been threatened, right? Or felt threatened. And I was like, if there's barber chairs in here, we're goose. Or else I'm going to have to work hard. But I love that when I meet people on this podcast or get to know them, like, I feel like I haven't, like, you're obviously your family man, you're married. I haven't seen you out much, but isn't it so funny that we could be 3 minutes, 5 minutes, yeah, 10 minutes away. We haven't crossed paths.
Yeah.
I'm spending more time in the sauna and steam room than probably on the gym floor. That's probably why I'm not seeing you in the gym. But even going to Dublin and coffee and pints, but we'll get to know that. I think it's very important that people get to know the face behind the brand, mm-hmm, and how much fucking hard work goes into it, because I remember how hard I worked to set up Cut and Sew 11 years ago. I remember, and I always tell this story, that I was on my hands and knees, like fucking painting the skirting boards, mm-hmm, to the, like cutting in with cardboard, because I had that level of detail and care. And it's important to know the story. And I haven't heard much of your story through my, mm-hmm, social channels, yeah, and friends. Can you tell me or tell us how the spark to, you know, serving your apprenticeship, Dublin Inc., would you call it an institution? It's very well known. People go to different tattoo, mm-hmm, works. I've had different people. But I'd love to know, what kind of sparked you? Did you always want to have your own studio? Or you're like, do you know what? Because I think I love what your brand is and what you do, but how do you say, I want to do this by myself, or go and do this, not work for someone else, how you want to work, you know? Do your own thing.
It was always in my head, you know? I was pretty like careful about just not doing it wrong, you know?
It shows.
You know, I had times where I thought about it, considered it, and just knew it wasn't the right time, you know? As you know yourself, it's tempting just to do it, you know, if you're that way inclined, you know. Mm-hmm. So Ro, who I have the shop with, we worked together in a few shops. And one day him or I just kind of said to the other one, like, what do we think about doing it? I think he said it to me. And the timing just kind of felt right.
I remember the buzz about him, because I know Ro through mutual friends, very nice lad. And I was recognizing him from the tattoos around.
Yeah, yeah.
I think he was hanging around with Dave McCabe and like the, mm-hmm, top man kind of crew. And that kind of pygmy, I don't know, he would have been an All Saints Pygmalion head. I didn't know him then,
thankfully. So,
and that's what I was thinking. I haven't seen you around.
Yeah.
So the brainchild is where, like, sparked the kind of idea. Like, can you tell us where the name came from? Or were you like, did you sit there and do a business plan and be like,
no, not at all. It was a few points. It was, yeah, pretty much.
Okay.
It's still that way.
I love few points. You get so creative.
Yeah.
Like, we're going to fucking set up a business.
It was honestly pretty straightforward, you know, like Ro's manager in the shop, you know, he managed top man, all that stuff. So he was,
I didn't want to ask, because like, man, he used to serve me. Like, he had all the tattoos. I think he's blacked a lot of them out.
They're gone.
Yeah.
So
I used to look up to him. I was like, he's a stylish fucker. I love all his tattoos. I remember asking him, he'll hear this and go, what? He goes, bro, could you know the David Beckham tattoo? Yeah. Like, where'd you get the clouds and all? Or, I don't know what he had.
So he, then I had a bit of security in being like, he knows how to manage people. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
To this day, my weakest point would be managing people, like as in, you know, yourself, and you have to deal with certain problems and that.
Yeah.
He's better at dealing with people than I am, you know?
Okay.
So we have just a good balance. Obviously, I tattoo. I kind of design the shops, that sort of thing. And he does the management side of it. So
he obviously works very well together. And I love hearing that. And it's great to see, because often or not, when you're in partnership, mm-hmm, in a business or whatever way it might work, or even working with rock stars, I call them, I use the football analogy.
Yeah.
Cut and Sew was like, I better not say Man United now because they're shit. Whoever's at the top, I tried to think of us. But you have your superstars in the shop.
Yeah.
But you also need your managers. Like, this is how long ago I'm watching football. Like, I still think of David Beckham. Lads, Ronaldo. I'm whoever owns Man United. And then you're Fergie. And you have to have these things. But it's nice to know how that works. But yeah, sorry, the name.
The name was tossed around a little bit. So Heartbreak comes from, I'm a massive Elvis fan. So Heartbreak Hotel was where that kind of came from. And then me and Ro both loved a shop in LA called Shamrock Social Club.
Of course.
And that was something that when I got into tattooing,
love that story.
That was kind of the shop I would have been like, that's
that's the place I want to work. You know
did
what I mean?
Did you like that style then?
The style, yeah. But it just wasn't here. I couldn't even Mahoney, get an apprenticeship. Mark Mahoney. And same row has like a brother that lives in LA. He had been over that way a lot.
I've gone
shop.
By it physically in person. I'm like, oh, I didn't go out. I think it was late. Like, we're going to so a gig. I remember going by. I'm like, whoa.
So it was kind of a mix of them. And that was as simple as that. And then, yeah, it was like...
Can you remember the first step? Because it's people see. I remember going, because Cable Tree, very cool. I remember like, I always wanted a shop there. And that's, it's hard. You're navigating around the city. Yeah, like it's hard to get like a lease.
Mm-hmm.
Then you're like, how do we do it and cost? And what age were you pretty much, just so people know?
I would have been maybe 23 probably.
Wow, man. It's fucking, that's gone. So that's, because I always thought you were a lot older based off how fucking beautiful the first shop was.
Yeah.
The next one is a mental animal.
That's the first one, even what the main thing was just...
It was only what you seen. Was there a bathroom in the back or not even?
It was literally, I'm not lying, it was like a closet door with just a toilet. You couldn't even close the door and you went into it. It was like, so we had to like... It was tiny. The shop was tiny.
I was in the back of a graffiti record shop. Didn't have...
Like the shop was honestly, if it was even... It was less than half of this, I'd say. It was tiny.
I remember, I think, when I used to go to... Tommy the Truth and like, you know, chatting people around. And the thing I like about tattoo shops are, well, I have a perception. I think they're scary as mm-hmm. fuck to go into. Or when I used to go, when I was 16, 18, whatever. And I go in, my idea was like heavy metal.
Yeah.
I go in and I'm like, oh my God. Plus you're getting your neck tattooed and you're in pain. And like, there's just these big hairy beasts right tattooed. If you AI tattoo.
That's how it would be.
I feel like that's what would come up. And I remember going in, I was like, man, this is so, I used to be able to get a load of tattoos. I was like, how many hours can I get for this?
Yeah.
And they'd be like, and I used to remember getting all these and I wasn't even flinching because I got it a bit sore at the end, mm-hmm. didn't drink alcohol, nothing. And then I remember when I got older, I was like, oh man, I need to go and have a pint. I remember saying, can I get like a little whiskey or something? But I used to love going in and chatting to Tommy because he's a legend. And for years I went, and then I changed. I kind of want to change styles and got onto my legs. But when I see Heartbreak Social, I feel like, I remember because I followed and got to know some of the staff at the start, and I goes, "This." I feel like there was a bit of a stigma change or break, mm-hmm. or has it changed, do you think, has it changed since how you've started? Because I just thought that's what it was, big rockers.
Yeah.
And big scary punks.
Yeah, like intimidating, yeah.
Yeah, and I feel like it's gone. I see your socials go through the roof, and the work and the clientele and the artists, it's like, is that kind of gone now?
It's still there, but...
Yeah, it's not moving.
They're not
in that
busy,
direction.
I don't think. You know what I mean? It's still there. Not so much in Dublin, but you get a lot. Even Americans, if you get shops like that where it's very traditional in that way. But here, when I started in Dublin Inc., that was probably the first shop
that
kind of changed it.
Okay.
You know, even when that started, I was going around shops looking for apprenticeships, and I had to find shops. There wasn't many around. You know,
did you have to go in and get tattooed? Like,
I just go in with portfolio drawings and like look for apprentice. Be
you
want?
Were you turned away loads or you know?
I got offered somewhere else.
Yeah.
So when I was getting first tattooed in Dublin Inc., they kind of mentioned about looking for an apprentice. Not to me. Overheard. Said to the guy, and he was like, "Bring me in your portfolio." You know. So I'd always been drawing all my life, but I never kept that, and I didn't have one drawing at home. So I literally went home for like a week straight, drew like 10 hours a day.
Wow.
Brought it back to him. Turned me away a few times, was like, don't like it.
Maybe I love this. Is the story. I love it. It's like,
yeah, I remember then he was like, I just want you, he asked me to draw one more thing or something. And he's a crazy dude. He still is.
Yeah,
you know?
Crazy.
He's not around here
way.
Anymore. He's long moved overseas. So
yeah.
he was a tough guy, you know. And he was asking for something else. I remember I went in one day
wasn't
with
good
it.
Enough for,
yeah. And I remember he just like kind of done 180 where he kind of flipped through it. And he was like, you know, actually, I don't really like what you're doing anymore. Not for me. And I remember I sat down at the end of Cow's Lane where like
the cafe.
Yeah. Down there. I remember like sitting on that wall. I was not even 18 yet. I remember just sitting there, my drawings just crying. And I was like, that's that.
Wow.
And I was so committed for whatever reason. I was like, I have to work in this shop because I went to the other shops. It had that kind of intimidating feel. I was like, it didn't suit me, you know? Then just, few more times I just went back to him with new drawings, and then one day he was just
and
like
not even going in to get tattooed, just to be like, whatever, Mr. X, here's some cooler drawings drawings or
no, just going back to him. And yeah, eventually then he was like, all right, let's do it, you know.
What was the difference from being 18 crushed to like, okay, you're better, or
do you know what it was?
You
it
didn't
was,
give up.
It was kind of a it was like a temporary high, because when I started the apprenticeship with him, it was like it was very traditional apprenticeship.
Is it dog rough? I hear
it doesn't exist anymore far as I know. Like my apprentices, it's like it doesn't have to be that way, but like I spent a year in there where it was just you know, you're
tattooing yourself pigskin or the
I was like for a year, like I was just drawing. I wasn't even a touching machine. My drawings had to be done at home. There's no drawings in there. It was like
cleaning.
He'd send me off to do shopping, he'd clean cars. That was a year straight. And if you
guys have it easy now,
7 days a week, no pay. And it's you, I'd be like, you know, maybe need a day off next week. He'd come up with some excuse that I'd have to be there that morning to do, you know, it was rough, but it was like earning your stripes sort of thing, which he did teach me, but days are gone. You wouldn't, even if you wanted to, you wouldn't get away with it. You wouldn't be allowed, you know?
You'd be getting brought to the small claims court now and the WRC. Yeah. I love it. I've never had in 11 years of cutting, so I've never had somebody come in and work free. They do a trial day or a couple of trial Saturdays to get the feel, because we shouldn't adapt to the people coming in. They should adapt to the culture of cutting. So when you open the door to a cutting saw, I love to think that it's very welcoming. The music is on point, and the vibe is, because there's 1,000 barber shops in Dublin, and I truly believe none of them have the same drive as we do. But I feel like every owner should feel like they're the best.
Of course, yeah.
You know what I mean? I'd be like, but true belief and by dedication to the craft and to the aesthetic, the design that people don't see. And that's why I like to do this. Mm-hmm. I feel like I want to get to know really amazing, inspirational people in all industries so I can better myself. Yeah. And when I see Heartbreak, I'm like, I need to chat to this lad and talk about his process of why have this shop. When you went from the first place, why did you suddenly decide to go to a way bigger unit? Was it simply because of traffic, or because you could have just stayed there and been comfortable, or shop two, you totally uprooted what I thought was the slickest shop I've ever seen in Ireland. And I still believe that Heartbreak Social is the best aesthetic, from the gold leaf design to the Jesus, the guns, the neon, the bikes, everything. Yeah, what made you go from Capel Street?
So when we went to Capel Street, that sort of was just like, we could get in there. It was so cheap. It was I fell in love with the building, which worked. You know, so when I saw that building, I was like, I love it. But wasn't the location I had in mind and stuff.
Yeah. But
just like, for me, I would have never even been over that way in town, you know? So people were kind of like, it's a bit out of the way, because it was obviously far in.
And
it wasn't
as cool and hip.
No, it was still, it was a bit madhouse.
I don't think there was Brother Hubbard and our chicken bovinities. Yeah, crew and all,
none of them were there. So it was sort of a means to an end, like price-wise. And even at that, it was like...
Was there three chairs at the start, or two, or
there
four?
There was three chairs from the start, but we started off with me and Lauren. So it was just us two working there.
Yeah.
I think we opened 5 days a week. And then I think within 6 months, there was 9 of us, and we're open 7 days a week.
And you just had to rotate chairs.
Just rotate. So 3 a day. So most people were doing, say, 4 a day. And then some people were doing evening shift.
Feel any type of, because I think it's, I don't know what the right word is. I feel like when the new blood comes in, like me, it's very similar. You have the Waldorf, you have all these Grafton barbers, the Grafton barbers always get to mention here, but they're like 60 shops in Ireland. It's a different beast to us. But when we started out, all of the old school lads who actually in Temple Bar, none of them are there anymore. Mm-hmm. We come in like, we're going to do social media. We're going to do, not TikTok, we're going to create videos, content. We're going to have new blood and adapt, because the way it used to be, you go in, you sit down, and it was horrible as a young man getting hair. You just be sit there, in and out, fiver, your man would be smoking, I remember. And it was like going to the dentist. Mm-hmm. I remember nearly crying. I used to not want to go get a haircut. And it's totally flipped now to being like, can't wait to get a bit fresh rain or whatever it is. But when you were like, was there any sort of intimidation to opening a business? You were like, I was a bit like, fuck you. Hang on there. I remember not being able to get a job. I remember in some barbershop, because I wasn't good enough, I was like, I'm going to do this, because I used to go to the Waldorf. I remember going and goes, whoa, this is like going back in time. They're all wearing the white overcoats. They're listening to the 60s or 40s music. And I remember getting like, I remember that was the haircut back in the day when Joe Burger was popping. To anyone that doesn't know Joe Burger, Joe Burger was the burger spot. They had DJs, and Joe Macken was ahead of his time. I remember going, I can do this if they can do it. I'm going to put hip hop or house music or whatever and fucking rebrand it.
Yeah.
Did you feel, I felt that in Dublin, there's nothing like that I want to be in. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to create my own.
Yeah, it was and exactly that. Yeah.
Was it? Yeah.
Yeah. I just, like as you're saying with, I guess barbering's probably the same, where nothing for me, but a lot of people can kind of have a lot to say about other artists, and it's, you know,
a lot of it,
you know.
And the older guys slandered us, and I won't name names because I'm not that type of guy.
Yeah,
but they fucking hate on, like, And you would hear them and they'd be like, that's a load of bollocks. Yeah, that's not how it's done. That's not traditional.
Yeah, that's their way.
That's their way. Yeah, and it actually, the front day fueled me to go and do this.
Yeah.
I wasn't intentional to be I actually am not ruthless at all, and I could totally be that person, but it's not who I am inside. I'm very organic and grounded, and I want people to come to work with us, whereas I think every other barbershop, they work for them. And that's I narrate that as clear as I can, and people believe it because it's in the pudding of the 11 years. Mm-hmm. So when you went from Capel Street to, I remember it was, I feel like it's very similar story to the cut and sew boom. Mm-hmm. I really mean that, because I was like, man, you need to, because no one did appointments for us. So, you know, how many years was Capel Street to then go to, what's the street you're on now? Because I always get Drury Street.
Drury Street, yeah.
Thank God I got that right. Yeah. So the size, I know that's an expensive street.
Yeah, it was quick, yeah. Like, we went in Capel Street on a 5-year lease. And at that stage, probably to yourself, you know, you're your first place and that, and it's going well. I would have signed up to 100 years. I was like, I just want this forever.
Yeah, I know.
I don't want that more. I'll just, you know, I was nearly a relief. Because I remember opening that shop, as small as it was, like in the lead up to it, I was like panicking. I was like, what am I doing here? You know, I was completely
electricity.
Like, I was like, this is a fucking stupid idea, you know?
Really?
And then, yeah, it just kind of hit the ground running. It was busy. Then that was May 2018. Then it would have been October 2019. So only a year and a half after that, we moved to Drury Street.
So you had the two locations?
Yeah. So when we came to
Drury
Street,
bananas.
We kept Capel Street. But just to see out the lease, I knew I didn't want to keep it there. And then when we went to Drury Street, we'd done it was a pretty big fit out. We did like a 6-month fit out, and we opened for one day, then went into lockdown, and we didn't get back open then. That was October. We didn't get back till, I think it was nearly May. So by the time we came back in May,
full rent? Did you get any relief?
Nothing, zero.
See, people don't, so it's even speaking to previous guests about that time, we didn't have anything in our lease or from our solicitor to say, if a worldwide pandemic hits, which it never has.
Yeah.
And for like 100 years since the crash back in the 20s,
yeah,
that we would have our rent paid. So a lot of people, we had four shops at the time, and I think all of the shops had to pay full rent, which not a lot of people know. Mm-hmm. There wasn't much relief. And I was like, man, this could be the end. Yeah. So that's how vulnerable it can be. Yeah.
And then straight back to going, I could have just been safe in that little shop. Kind of made a leap of fate. And then like, by the time we reopened, we were at a stage where it's like, if it's one more month, it's like, we're minus at this stage, you know.
It was a horrible feeling, wasn't it?
When it was scary, yeah. And like that, we just
done accountable for it.
A beautiful shop. And I was like, remember open for one day and how amazing it was. And then I was like, it was close to going, that's the only day we're ever going to have here. You know, it was like.
And days, and you're like, and you literally couldn't tattoo because there was people definitely doing lots of lockdown haircuts.
Yeah.
It was a great time for a lot of people. And then I was like, I couldn't cut hair because I was the owner. If somebody had me like cutting at home, this could be the end of the brand. And it was, I think was it 4 years or so? I remember, I heard a rule that every 7 years, shit hits the fan. Mm-hmm. And when we opened up, I remember it being a kind of post-Celtic Tiger-y. And I remember getting into the graffiti shop and being like, can I, you know, cut hair and put a mirror up? And it was the photo I always reshare. It's a little kitchen chair, mirror from my mom's gaff, and a box. And I just put my shit on it like this. And I was like, doing a nixer in my mom's kitchen. Yeah. I remember it going like that. The story came from, I don't know, the belief and hunger and wanting to make it.
Mm-hmm.
And a question I always, I remember making my first, I think it was a 10 or a 15 euro there. Can you remember taking your first tattoo that you did in Heartbreak? Please say it's an Elvis one or probably not
Heartbreak.
Though.
Do you know what? First one I did in Heartbreak, I remember.
Or can you remember your first ever tattoo?
First ever, I remember. And like for the first while, tattooing, you still don't get paid, you know, because you're an apprentice. So you have to,
and you want to mates and all.
But I remember the first guy that, and it was the same, it was a tenner. I remember he gave me like a tenner tip for doing it.
Oh, yeah.
And I literally, it's like I had the worst memory in the world. Like if you ask me that apprenticeship, there's not much I can remember. And I remember taking that tenner. And
everyone
I had that moment
so
of like, I was like, right, you know, like that's like, why just do 10 of these a day? I was like, then I can live. And then like, you know, it seems like a reality now. It's like someone gave me money for doing it. And that's, I was like, right, I should only get fucking better anyway. So that was when just, you know, you have that moment where you go, right, obviously I'm getting closer. And then it was from there, you push on, obviously, and take more tenors.
It's funny. And it's like, so again, from what I see online, could you describe to people what kind of style it is that might, because we don't have any like, well, we probably might have people that are mad into tattoos. Mm-hmm. Nearly everyone has them. It's rare if you don't.
Yeah.
I don't want to shit all over your style or get it wrong with style because I haven't. How would you describe? Are you? Can you do whatever? Or do you specialize or like a certain type of?
Yeah, like my apprenticeship, I would have did everything. So I kind of over the years done everything, and then just now segued into just doing what's called single needle. So that's pretty much
what you would see on your socials.
The smallest you can make a tattoo, essentially, is you know. So back in the day. Still, maybe a lot of artists, if you want to get, say, a portrait of whatever, say you want a portrait of your mom, they'll probably tell you it needs to be like 5-6 inches. And that's just due to the equipment they use.
Yeah.
With what I use, it's like you could do it at maybe an inch or two. You know, you can
I didn't realize because, you know, when you see a picture on a grid on social media, you're like, what is this? The only name that's coming to mind that I would know, was it Mr. Wu or?
Dr. Wu.
Dr. Wu. Remember it was because... Is that the style? It's not like micro tattooing, but it can
So he was, he apprenticed.
Is he pretty big in your world?
He apprenticed under Mark Mahoney, the guy that owns Shamrock Social. So he was his apprentice. And Tommy, Tommy worked there while he apprenticed.
Because I know the stories and he tells me. And so I've got the, I don't want to say cheesy, but a lot of them are. I've nearly every bad tattoo apart from tribal, which is probably cool now, right? So, but like, you know, I have the Chinese, I have the like the Arabic beside the thing and the Beckham and the skulls and the hearts and whatever. I don't have the clock with like nanny or granddad. And I always ask when I'm like getting tattoos from different people and I have an LA and you know all this. Do you think when at your age you are now, I always say like create the content you can or consume the content you create or create the content. So I like when I'm cutting hair, there's a certain haircut and cuts I like to do. So I put that out. Would it be similar to you whereas like if you want to continue to do more of this stuff that means a lot and that's, you know, of a certain type of art, that's what you do? Or do you actually ever have time to do like, I want to get a shamrock or I want to get a certain type of thing? Or does someone have to, what's the process like to get a tattoo yourself? I may as well have a consultation with you while I'm here.
Yeah, usually it'll be a case of whenever, say, I'll fill up bookings for a period of time.
Okay.
And that's coming to an end then, I'll open my website where you can just send in booking requests. So essentially you go on, you fill out what you want to get done.
And is it an email? It's email.
So I have a website and it's just like a booking form on it. And it's kind of just you fill in the gaps.
And you have to pay a deposit.
So what happened is when they get sent in, I'll open that for like this time, I just opened it for 12 hours. So then people just, I'll send them in.
And, I'll
go through them then with a booking manager and I'll just pick out the ones I want to do.
Wow.
They get back to them ones. And then like, unfortunately say this time it's like, even if I wanted to, some of them just wouldn't be my style and stuff. So I'd be like, Paul can do it better anyway.
Yeah.
But even if I wanted to, I couldn't fit them all in because this time I booked more than usual.
And it's taxing, I'm sure.
It's a lot ahead. So if I book too far ahead and then something's up when the kids are sick and you move people, like people don't like being told they'll reschedule you 6 months away, you know? And that's kind of where you have to be careful with how far you go. But yeah, I'll just go through them.
Yeah.
Pick out the ones that suit me the best.
And then like the studio manager will be like, right, we have these options. And you know, base, because obviously would it be, I'm sure when you fill it out, you'll know that's going to take a half day. Here's the price.
Yeah.
Do you take full payment or deposit?
We just take a deposit. So every booking with me, it's €100 deposit for any tattoo.
Wow.
That's it. And then that will just come off on the day.
Man, that's very nice because it's like, you know, with someone so high in demand and so respected and anyone that I've mentioned their name to being excited about, oh my God, I'm getting Ryan on. They're like, fuck. Like, and it's very distinct. It's really like, I nearly know. When people come into the barbershop, I love talking about kicks, tattoos, watches. I don't drive yet. So I don't really know it, but I'm like, who did this? And I love the culture behind when you're sitting in the barber chair, get to know somebody and building a relationship.
Yeah.
And it's real nice that when people come to me, sometimes I mightn't get on with them. And I'm, as I've gotten older, to certain people, I'm like, John can actually, there's no John's worker, but just John can do it better. And I think it's important to say no to things as well. Because I'm like, I don't enjoy doing this. I actually don't shave, which is mad to the classic old school barbers. I've never wanted to. I don't enjoy doing it. And look how well we've done in barbering and cutting. So, whereas we have people who love doing beards and they can charge a premium and they're better than me. And it's like, you know, I'm sure you could tattoo as well as anyone else in certain areas. But if you enjoy that style, that's kind of what you do.
Mainly as part of yourself. It's, of course, someone could probably do it better. But even that aside, it's, I don't enjoy it. And that's the main thing, you know? I wouldn't say that to a customer, you know? They're going to hear it. I'm not doing it because I don't enjoy it. I'll say, Paul can do it better, which if I'm saying it, he can.
And you're in a position that you can be like, you know, if you can't pick everyone, you can't make everyone happy. It's the same with me. People will see Sean on the booking link. I can't get you on these days, you're booked out. And I'm like, I actually have seen a lot of barbers now doing it, which I like, whereas I'm not taking on any new clients because in our industry, it's repeat custom.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, if you're busy enough to not need it, which is great, and I'm sure it's a nice luxury, but you've earned that for years of sacrifice and whatever.
Yeah.
To bring some kind of a level to it, because everyone sees, oh my God, he owns this amazing brand. They're booked out. They're doing busy. I've seen as well, you've gone on to do other elements within the shop. I actually love the clothing. What else? Is there a piercing? Is there jewelry? Piercing. Is there now coffee?
Yeah, yeah.
It's all organic. Do you guys kind of say to yourself, here's a business plan, or do you have a whiteboard at home, we're going to do this and we're going to do this numbers, or it's just kind of still rolling in the right direction, or do you have a business plan? I map out the year a little bit.
Yeah, like a little bit. I'll like, the ideas would be pretty organic where I'll just think about it for a good while. You know, I won't even write it down. I'll just think about it. If it's good idea for long enough, then I'll start to write it down and stuff. But I have so many ideas that honestly, I could sell my soul to an idea tonight and in the morning be like, what was I thinking? You know, I just always have new ideas. So I've learned to go give it 6 weeks and then tell someone, you know. So
have you read any books that people might go, oh, fuck. Like, you know, like I'm trying to get into a few books. Some of them I can't read, like The Power Now, couldn't read Law of Attraction and Visualize. I couldn't do that. I get inspiration from stories and like, I know, Andre Agassi's book and Phil Knight from Nike. Yeah. I'm like, or whoever, like Ronnie O'Sullivan's book. I love all these people, but nothing got to do with what? There's no barber books.
Yeah, it doesn't. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, kind of similar.
I get ideas.
Like more, like I don't read. This year was one of the things where I was like, people have said to me, they're like, even just listen to audiobooks. Because there's loads of, even people I'm interested in, I'd like to read the book, but me reading is just, I don't have the concentration. I'm terrible. I can't watch a movie. Like if there's a movie on at home, I can't do it.
What's the one with Mark Mahoney in it? Johnny Depp. Does he get
Black
killed?
Mass.
Black Mass.
Yeah, yeah.
Surely you watch that, but once you see him, you're like, right, I'm going back on Instagram or TikTok or whatever. Back to the emails. So for me, I love the idea of the shop and it's, everyone thinks it's great and profitable, but you might resonate. I feel like I was making more money in the first shop, in the basement of the graffiti shop when it was like, bum, 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 bum. It just felt like there was like five chairs and they were all rocking. Mm-hmm. And now we've like a few shops. I'm like, I don't know if it's just because my chapters of my professional thing are changing. Mm-hmm. And there's something, I don't get imposter syndrome. I believe in what we do. I feel like I'm working as hard as I can for the brand. Is there a hard transition when you become an owner and a boss? And do you feel like the weight of responsibility? Because essentially, I remember Tom Lutu telling me, he goes, will you be happy just being a barber, you know? And I'm like, yeah, like if I lost it all today, my dad always said, how do you open another shop or have belief? I'm like, I believe in it. And if one shop closed, another shop closed, and I had to go and cut hair, I would still know I can make a really good wage and I'm a good craftsman and I'm great with people. I believe that if it all went tomorrow. But then all of a sudden, I remember, like you, it just snowballed so quick.
Yeah.
People are like, we can actually now book haircuts online. And they do that better than the old school lads at walk-ins. Mm-hmm. And they enjoyed it more.
Yeah.
But then I was like, fuck, I'm actually a boss. I fucked up loads with not realizing the correct rate of pay. Mm-hmm. I remember paying loads of the lads' taxes for about a year. I spent a fortune paying all the staff taxes. Probably deposit on a house. I'm not even kidding you. That wasn't very dangerous when focused. But then we become, they kind of want you. And like, I'm like getting pulled each way. And I'm like, man, I have to listen to people when their cat dies or they're late to work or there's a flood or the darts late. And I'm like, boom, boom, boom. It's overwhelming.
Yeah.
So like, do you have a big team now or what's going, do you know how many is on the books or how many people are in Heartbreak?
Altogether, we've 30 people now. A lot of them probably seem like, I don't know if barbers probably do it, where a lot of the artists would be self-employed.
Yeah, yeah.
But we still have probably half of them are like employed. And then when it comes to everyone else in the shop, like the piercers, managers, all that stuff, they're all employees, obviously. So we've like, I think about 30 altogether, probably about 15 employees. Yeah.
Man, it's a credit to you. 31, good head of hair, I think, under the hat.
Nah, you'd be surprised.
Stress, yeah. And the gray hairs are kicking
but
in.
It is, yeah. It's, I don't think people, not that I like need them to realize it, but it's, people don't realize the stress of it.
So here, perfect cue up. So what's a stress that people mightn't realize or a worry? Because I could tell mine, but I want to know yours, that you're like, man, I didn't think I'd be worried about this or that. What keeps you up late at night? Is there anything that people might know to add, you know, to show a little bit more of a yin and yang to running a business, that it isn't all highlights and it isn't all going to the bank and getting money. You know, what's it? Fuck, man, I didn't realize that we have to pay rates, whatever. Is there anything that people, that really bugs you or that's hard that people mightn't know, like, that side to you?
From when I started the business to now, like, I'll never ever change my mind in this, where I'm like, it's ridiculous. I was never taught any of this in school and some of the shit I had to do. It's amazing. Mental. And then I have people knocking on my door. That's like a tax man or someone from the Work Relations Commission going.
WRC,
I had them in a few months ago. That was an absolute stress. Nothing was wrong. Everything was fine. But I remember for a few months asking for something.
That was
and
the
in
most
my head,
thing that happened to us.
I'm going, what's going to happen here? Are we on timesheets or everything? We want, you know, and it's just a big mess of shit. And in the end, they just kind of go, yeah, that's grand. And then I, which is the example, 6 months later, I'm kind of going, oh, there was no issue in the end. And straight away, I was kind of in my head going, oh, we're going to get shut down or something.
That's so
you know,
bad.
And it's
the
no
WRC.
One,
was...
No one ever taught us that. No one told me that. Same with taxes. I remember when I got to first place and I was like, right, we'll pay this. This is our rent. This is great. Then your man, like, the first day we're in there was like, oh, you need to send us over for your rates. I didn't even know rates was a thing. You know what I mean? And I was
were
like, how much is that?
On Cable Street? Like, a couple of thousand?
I think Cable Street was actually, it seemed expensive at the time, but I think they were only about 1,000.
Nothing like Drury Street, I'm sure.
Like Drury Street's rates are, we have a double shop where our rates are 13 grand.
Okay.
Yeah. And you know, that's money where I'm sure you know, everyone like, where the fuck's
people
that going?
People don't see, you know? That, before you open the door, you rent and 30, I won't even know, I don't even need to know, but 13,000, we're 7,000 for the shop. And I'm like, 7,000 worth of cuts have to come in here.
Yeah.
Plus the rent, which is a lot more expensive, and every other bill before there's a penny profit.
Exactly.
And I didn't learn that. And I think if there was like an entrepreneur school of whatever, I'd love it. I don't remember much from geography. I remember good bits of history because I liked it, but CSPE, I don't even know what the other subjects are, religion, any of that. If I was rich, I'd have my own school, like what Elon Musk and all is doing. My kids would be like, this is how you do your taxes. This is how much you pay yourself. This is a company expense. All this stuff.
Yeah, it is scary, you know.
But it is scary. Yeah,
and
that's a lot.
Those, you know, when you get some bills, then you're looking at it and you're going, what's that about? You know, and
every second month
pay
is
things,
the worst.
I used to pay things like, the second accountant could like get onto me and be like, you have to pay X amount for blah, blah, blah. I didn't even know what it meant. And I just pay it, you know. And I'm like, they come and go. I'd never even question it, you know. And now, obviously, when something comes in, I'm like, what exactly is that? I have different accountants. They're better at it, you know, that sort of thing. But I remember back in the day when I first opened, it was like, if you had a knock on my door and said, I'm Sean from blah, 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 you have to pay 800, I'd be like, oh shit, pay. You know, I was just deer in the headlights, you know what I mean?
I know.
And only like, for, you have the passion
you're learning
for the shop,
it as you go on. And
you're willing to push through, but yeah, like the system isn't there to help you, that's for sure.
And you know, it's very good because from my eyes, and you are very successful in this way, but I did a workshop there about how to make six figures, right? And I'm like, they're like, what? And I'm like, well, it's actually how hard it is to. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying I make that, but I'm like, here's the reality that what I try and tell people is, in Ireland, this is very good. You can earn now up to 42,000 a year when you're self-employed, I think, or an employee at the 20% tax rate. But the second you earn over 42,000 a year, 50% goes to the government.
Yeah.
There's no incentive from, if I'd have known this, I'd just be all the taxi drivers tell me more about business than anyone else. I love it. So shout out to the taxi. We'd have to get like a really good taxi driver. Yeah. But he'd be like, them fucking blade bastards. No, like, they don't cash our sum up our revenue up. Like, you know, but they're like, this is how much you can earn. And and I'm like, talking to the people, I'm like, they don't give us much incentive as business owners.
Yeah.
None of us are scrounging here. We're paying rates, rent, we're paying landlords, whatever, their rent and their for their buildings. We're employing people, we're supplying people, we're enriching the streets and communities we're in. And I'm like, there's no break. Let us earn a substantial amount more money. Mm-hmm. We're going to start a riot, actually. But I'm like, I want to earn big money. I can't earn big money. It's hard to get a mortgage as a business owner now. I'm like, we need 12 years of accounting. But if I work in Dunn's, nothing wrong with Dunn's. I worked there as a kid. But if I work in Dunn's, and I earn less than me, I get more of a mortgage purely because I'm an employee versus being a business owner.
It's crazy.
Bananas.
I went to my first mortgage meeting with my wife a few years ago. I went to AIB, trod him under the bus, and went in. And I swear to God, from the get-go, I was like, he's just not taking me seriously. I just knew he wasn't, you know.
Regardless
some
of.
Old lad. Yep. And he was kind of asking me this, that, and the other. And I swear to God, he was like, you're not in the position yet. I knew I wasn't, you know, I was just kind of, it's a mortgage. I was like, tell me what I need to do, you know? And I remember at the end, he goes, off the record, I'll give you a bit of advice. And I was like, yeah, brilliant.
And we're going to rinse him out here.
He goes, you should close your business. He goes, go work for someone else. He goes, be a tattoo artist. He goes, make your money, be an employee. And he goes, come back to me. And he goes, we can give you a mortgage.
And in 6 months, I'd say, that's all they needed. Yeah.
And that's what he said. He goes,
and,
6 months.
And that's how many years ago was that?
That was only 3 years ago.
And you know what's funny? I met a guy that's like, Sean, I used to have a huge gym, very successful coach. And he's like, I actually now work for a company and try and get big money. And I don't do anything. And he goes, and I got approved for way more just to get a house.
Crazy.
I get it. People love having a business and being, I see it all the time now. It isn't as glamorous as you. I'm obviously going to try and protect my business. We don't share rent after COVID. It doesn't work for us as a brand and in the industry. I think tattooing, it works way better in because you do, I don't know how it works, but we have a good pay system that we reward people based on. It's quite commission.
Yeah.
The busier they are, the more money they get.
Yeah.
100%. But it's not week by week. It's kind of like it should always get busier.
Mm-hmm.
And a few years ago, when we were hitting COVID, it was hard times. And we made a decision. We just like shut up a shop. Would we share rent? Would we do this? And we stuck it out. And it's worked really well for us that we don't share rent and it protected the brand.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any fear in like, it happens all the time. You have a really good tattoo artist in the shop. They didn't want to go down the road. I think it'd be very hard to do what Heartbreak Social has done.
Yeah.
But does it hurt? Has anyone ever left you? And has anyone ever screwed you over or fucked you over? I'd love to know. And how have you come back from that? Because it happened to me. But again, I'd love to add some yin and yang to like your story so people don't think it's all highlights.
Like as far as the shop goes with employees, we've been lucky, you know. Like one of our main things going in, like as a shop, I said, like, it looks great. Like,
yeah.
One of my biggest passions is like interior design, all that sort of stuff. My wife's an interior designer. So we love that side of it. You know what I mean? That's our dream thing. Like if I could leave tomorrow and just design houses and stuff, I'd do that. You know, I just like that.
But
you can't afford it. So we kind of set that up, looks great. And always the point was, I think similar to yourself, was that I want this place to be good to work. Cause I've been placed where I was like, didn't feel like I was treated right or whatever it was. So like whoever comes in, I'm going to give you the best place to work.
And love that.
We're going to essentially work together.
Yeah.
And I'll be fair to you, you be fair to me. So because of that, we've really good staff turnover. No one's really left.
Same as us.
7 years, like we've had, I think, two people go who are just moving overseas, you know.
There's nowhere better to go,
If anyone leaves, I know there's no hard feelings. So everyone has their own route, go ahead. But yeah, I just don't think, like, there's no one that could ever do anything that would upset me. Even if someone did something shitty,
that's not in your
I got to the stage and I'm under this like umbrella with everyone in the shop where I'm like, the shop's now bigger than any of us. No one comes in there. It's not like, there's no Ronaldo. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Where you're kind of going, oh, well, we'll change because we keep Ronaldo. It's like, it's a team effort and it's, you know.
I used that, sorry, and I read an Alex Ferguson book years ago and he was like, the second somebody thinks they're bigger than the umbrella or the team, which is like Heartbreak, or so they need to go.
Yeah.
And I believe there's nowhere better to go in Ireland. There might be a different places that suit you more, or like a small studio.
Yeah.
But I believe people only either go to open their own barbershop and or go away. And more times than not, it's to move abroad.
Yeah.
And I love that. And it's like, I feel that from you because I never hear anything bad. It's a beautiful space. And it's like what you've done in a couple of years of business is mind blown. And I can't believe how quick our chat's gone, but I kind of want to ask one question before the main question, if Dangerous When Focused means anything to you. And I love the fact I've had to chat about like the interior design, because that totally shows. That was something I wanted to ask you massively. What pretty much is next? Because I've seen the coffee come on. I think you've broke the internet a few times, AKA Loving Dublin and all this. And I was like, and he got there. I'd love to do coffee and I never did it. But what's next for Heartbreak Social? And what does Dangerous When Focused mean to you, if anything?
I think for Heartbreak now, it's been so fast, you know, where like what we're nearly 6 years since we started first day in Cable Street.
I feel like it's like an institution, like 11 years. I feel like.
And that was always the aim for me and Ro, was that it was going to be a destination. Do you know what I mean? Where like, I didn't know how we do it, but I was like, I want to save your tourist, that some people want to go to Heartbreak that weren't even getting a tattoo. And that's why we kind of introduced other things, blah, blah, blah. But
they can come in and grab a hoodie, get period.
Whatever it is. Just get a coffee. It's kind of, it's an experience.
And you can walk in and just kind of have a little chat. Look, that's,
So it's, I think now, like, the most beneficial thing to it will be just letting it fester and letting it grow. Like, I always wanted it to feel like it's been there for 100 years. That was always the aim, you know what I mean? And you kind of stir the pot when you put something new in every time. So now,
shake it up. It's like a healthy shake. I like that, man. I need to shake it up here.
I feel like it's at the stage now where it just needs to all just stay for a while and just enjoy it.
It's like a
bit.
Snow globe. Yeah. You're shaking it with the new elements and see. And you only know what, you know, the saying where, like, if you don't try, it's 100% fail.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like me. I would love, because I love coffee, I'd love to have a, I just think I love my branding, or the branding to be like cut and sew, to mess around. Like you have, I love the Heartbreak coffee cups, and actually not to be profitable. If broke even, I would like it.
That's our coffee is literally, the idea behind that was,
you all drink coffee.
We make it cheap. I don't drink coffee.
Oh, okay, so there you go.
If we can make it cheap enough, and the thing is, right, other coffee shops, it's their business. So they have to pay the rents on that. So that's why when people go, oh, why is that place a fiver? Some of them are expensive, but if you have a coffee shop on Drury Street and you're just selling coffee, that's got to be expensive to make that rent.
Of course.
So I get it, right? It's not our...
It's not your business, yeah.
Right? So we're breaking even anyway. We're fine. So the coffee's extra. So, like, the coffee we use is... We'd load to different testers. It's even cost-wise, it's up there with, like, top coffee. It's not cheap coffee.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Yeah, coffee. I believe you.
So same with the coffee cups. Good suppliers, and it still comes to a place where we can charge €2 all coffees and pay our staff, and literally we just break even. There's not a cent of profit.
Very honestly.
And the reason we did it was, it was just a marketing thing, and it'll be there forever. But I was like, I could be putting £500 into Instagram ads, I could be doing Google, I could be, so this thing just breaks even.
Yeah.
And it gets an extra, like, we do 300 coffees a day. That's an extra 300 people through our door every single day.
Wow.
So then people come in and they go, I'll get a piercing, I'll get a hoodie, I'll get a...
Yeah.
So that was just the idea. That's like, rather than putting this out there and you're like, people are on their phone and it's getting thrown at them, like, I don't want to see you. It's like, these people are actually physically stepping in your door, and a lot of them will just get coffee and leave. But I can guarantee you, most of them, if they're going to get a piercing or they're going to get a tattoo, they'll probably go to that place. You know what I mean?
Wow.
So that was the idea. It doesn't make money. It pays itself and just gets people in the door. So it's nice. So that's why, like, some people get upset. Other coffee shops,
no,
they're not ripping people off. Okay. Some might be a little.
I like it. You're actually doing the coffee business is a credit and a bit of a solid.
Yeah, yeah.
So thank you so much. I'm like, man, I can't believe how quick that went.
I know, is that an hour?
Yeah, it's mental. Yeah, like Sam's like giving me the 5 minute mark about 5 minutes ago. And I'm like, oh, I think season one, you've been an amazing guest. So I wanted to ask you loads of questions about tattoos and bad ones, but we might do it again. Who knows? We might do it in Heartbreak. We should be doing that. Cool. I think we should do guest podcasts in their businesses and places next year. We're coming for Cassie Stokes. We might do the whole like thing where we go in and interview people outside their business.
Yeah.
Does dangerous and focus mean anything to you, or do you like the tagline? Or I won't take any offense, because it's just something we ask guests and everyone usually has a different answer at the end of the podcast.
Yeah, like something like that. Like, I think it's just, even for me, like, I was probably, when I started tattooing, like an underachiever at tattooing. It wasn't good at the start.
Okay.
It wasn't like I hit the ground running, you know? I get apprentices now and the first tattoo, I'm like, fuck off. Like, you know, it took me years to get there. So without having that focus, it's like, I don't know where I'd be working. You know what I mean? And it's like, for me, it's just, if you're focused, you don't need to be the best at it, but you could be the most successful at it. If you're the most focused, will win. That's what I think. You could be really, 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 you could be more talented than me at tattooing.
Like zoning in,
but I bet you I'll be busier, guarantee you. And that's what I think focus does.
Yes. Man, my pleasure. Ryan, my pleasure. Thank you so much. Everyone knows Heartbreak Social. Can't wait for this to come out and the response. Brother, thanks very much.
My pleasure. Thank you.